The caption for this morning meditation, Success of the Wicked. Success of the Wicked. We are going to meditate on Psalm 73, the full psalm. We are going to meditate on Psalm 73. Verse 1, it's a psalm of Asaph. It's a psalm of Asaph. Asaph, or at least to the credit of Asaph, there are 12 psalms in the Bible. 73 to 83, 11 psalms. And psalm number 50, altogether 12 psalms are ascribed to Asaph. Then we shall understand who this Asaph was. Generally we think that all the psalms were written by David. So a question comes, who this Asaph was? Asaph was a Levite, a son of Berkiah. His father's name was Berkiah. And Asaph was appointed by the chief of the Levites at the command of David with two others. They have also written psalms in the Bible. Or at least there are psalms in the Bible for their credit. Amen and Ethan, to preside over a part of the sacred choral services of public worship. So they were to lead the public worship, and Asaph, Ethan, and Heman. There are psalms to their credit. And he was recognized as a prophet, as a seer, and as a poet in the book of Isaiah, Hezekiah, in the book of Chronicles, Hezekiah would be saying. We must have the songs of David and Asaph the seer. Asaph the seer. So, there were sons of Asaph, and sons of Asaph were also in the worship team. Sons of Asaph were also in the worship team. So Asaph was a very, very important person. So this psalm, Psalm 73, is credited to Asaph. But we don't understand the sequence or the situation behind this composition. What was the reason that he composed this song? But it's not a question whether it's Asaph or David. Psalm 73 very much reflects the feelings and the thought process of all saints. The psalm has got in our Bible 28 verses, and we are going to read all those 28 verses. And I have divided with a sincere prayer, waiting in the presence of God for hours. I have divided that psalm into seven subheadings. Seven subheadings. For your benefit, I'm giving those subheadings on the screen so that you can make a note of these subheadings. Number one, verses 1 and 2, perplexity vanished. Perplexity vanished. So the end comes in the beginning. He was perplexed about something, and that perplexity is vanished. So he gives that at the first. Then he, what were the problems or the things, he moves on further. Verse, second point, from verse 3 to 14. From verse 3 to 14. Cause for confusion. What was the real cause for that confusion? You can make a note of these things. Number 3. From verse 13 to 16, pinned to pain, a lot of pain in his heart because of the confusion. Because of the confusion, there was a lot of pain in his heart. Verses 17 and 18, solution sought. He seeks for a solution. He seeks for a solution. Solution sought. Fifth point, from verse 19 to 22. He was foolish, but he finds out. For his confusion, he says the cause for his confusion was his foolishness. And he was able to find out. He was able to understand what he could not understand earlier. The sixth point, from verse 23 to 26, from verse 23 to 26 is confidence. And the seventh point, after all these confusions, after finding out a solution, he states the final verdict. The continuation of the final verdict is his first point. The continuation of his final verdict is his first point. Perplexity vanished. Verses 1 and 2. He gives the finding first. We'll read verse 1 and 2. Truly, God is good to Israel. Truly, whatever the situations may be. Truly, God is good to Israel. Truly, God is good to Israel. Even to such as are of a clean heart. He is good to all Israelites. When, especially to the Israelite with a clean heart. An Israelite with a clean heart, he is good. In verse 2 he says, but as for me. In the original there is no but. As for me. He is good. As for me, my feet were almost gone. My feet, it was not gone. Almost gone. My steps had well nigh slipped. I was about to make a mistake. Almost. I was wondering what that could be. Probably he thought that he wanted to leave the Levite team. He didn't want to be in the choir. He didn't want to do the ministry. He didn't want to worship the Lord. He probably wanted to become an atheist. Almost gone. Almost gone. I got a book with me. Towards the end of her life, I don't know how her end was, but towards the end of her life, Mother Teresa, after seeing all the sufferings of the people, it was too difficult for her to believe in God. Almost she became an atheist. In that book I got the letter she wrote to her bishop. She says, if there is a God, God you believe, please pray that the God could give me faith. In other words, she lost faith. Because she could see the sufferings of the people. God might have been merciful on her. I don't want to sit on a judgment of her end. But there are many occasions in our life. Almost we give up our hope. But he comes to a conclusion. Surely God is good. God is good to the Israelites with a clean heart. God is good to the Christians with a clean heart. So we move on to point number 2, from verse 3 to 14. What was the cause for his confusion? What was the cause for his confusion? The very reading will help you. Verse 3. For I was envious at the foolish or at the wicked. When I saw the prosperity of the wicked. When I saw the success of the wicked. When I saw the prosperity of the wicked. It's not the financial prosperity. Everything what they do, it prospers. It comes to pass. I know they are wicked people. When I saw the prosperity of the wicked, I was about to sleep. Verse 4. For there are no bands in to their death. There are no bands in their death. The literal meaning, there are no fetters. There is no problem until they die. They are very successful for some time. Then towards the end they suffer. Then at least the world could see this is the punishment for the wicked. There is no fetter to their death. Until they die, they have no suffering. Until they die, they have no suffering, but their strength is firm. Till the end, their strength is firm. No headache, no neck pain, no leg pain, no hip pain, no BP, no sugar. No problem for them. I don't understand this God. There's a problem with the Asaf. Verse 5. They are not in trouble as other men. They are not in trouble as other men. No wife problem, no husband problem, no children problem. Other men, they get all these problems. The wife is a nagging one. The husband is a rowdy. The children are disobedient. The parents serve the Lord. The children are disobedient. They don't respect the parents. But see, the children of this wicked man, Appa, Sharipa, Adupa, the wife, Adunga, Sharinga. What is this nonsense? They are wicked. They don't have the sufferings of any ordinary man. So they are not in trouble as other men. Neither are they plagued like other men. As I told you about the sickness, that financial problem, the children problem, that daughter problem, son-in-law problem, daughter-in-law problem, mother-in-law problem. They are not plagued like other men. They are wicked people. They are foolish. They don't have a problem in this world. Verse 6. Therefore, pride compasses them about a chain. Literally, it's not that pride compasses them about a necklace. In some translation, the word necklace. But the literal meaning is not like a necklace or a chain. The literal meaning is pride chokes them. They are choked with pride. How do you pride avala nerukkidu sutti pride da left la thirumna pride right la thirumna pride munna patta pride ah pesana pride chircha pride pride chokes them. Violence covers them as a garment. As a garment is round about us, pride covers them as a garment. Verse 7. Their eyes stand out with fatness. Only the very talk, their eyes. Their eyes stand out with fatness. Our kangal kolupinal yedupai parkar. Kolupavula kolupitimur. Wicked people. We are scared. The way they talk, kolupu pudichipaswang. They stand with the stand out with fatness. They have more than heart could wish. They have more than heart could wish. The blessing for a believer is God desires the heart, desires, God gives you the desire of your heart. God gives you the desire of your heart. They get more than what their heart could wish. Here a cycle. He joined the politics. He became some butter chayalala, this and that. A few days back he was saying, I want to buy a bike. I want to have a bike. No education, no background. Within a few days we see he is going in an Innova. Krista. Got a fortune now. He gets more than what his heart could wish. நமக்கு இருக்குதுன்னு காணாம போயிடுது. எவனா சைக்கிளை சுட்டுட்டு போயிடலாம். என்ன ஆண்டவர் சாமி கும்பிட்டு என்ன பிரயோஜனம்? அவர் போய் பைக் வருமா பைக் வருமா பைக் கிடைக்குமான்னு பார்த்தேன். இருந்த சைக்கிளை அவனை சுட்டு போயிட்டான். அவன் சைக்கிள் வச்சுட்டு ஏதாவது செகண்ட் ஹேண்ட் பைக் இருந்தால் சொல்லுங்க சார்னா, ஏதோ இந்த வட்டம் அரை வட்டம் கால் வட்டம் இந்த ரவுடி இந்த ஹையர் லிங்க்ஸ் ஹி ஜாயின் குரூப் சச் தட் டுடே இஸ் கோயிங் இன் அ ஃபார்ச்சுனர். Today he is going in a fortuner. He gets more than what his heart could wish. So we go to verse 8. They are corrupt. We know they are corrupt. They and speak wickedly concerning oppression. They speak wickedly concerning oppression. They speak wickedly. Literally it means சீர் கெட்டு போய். They are corrupt. No discipline, no proper discipline. சீர் கெட்டு போய். They are corrupt. And speaketh wickedly concerning oppression. And they speak loftily. They set their mouth against the heavens. I know one person told me, நான் போயிட்டே இருப்பேன் ஆண்டர் என் பின்னால் வரணும். நான் போயிட்டே இருப்பேன் ஆண்டர் என் பின்னால் வரணும். I've seen some people, they keep God always in their pocket. They do what all they want to do and God must help them. They do what is right in their heart and God must sanction everything. He told me openly, நான் போயிட்டே இருப்பேன் ஆண்டர் என் பின்னால் வரணும். நான் போயிட்டே இருப்பேன். They speak against heavens and their tongue walketh through the earth. Everywhere they got influence. G3 police station, I know, you go and tell that inspector, I'll go and tell. It is in the Kilpak, Kilpak I know. Secretariat, I know, their tongue walketh all through the earth. Secretariat, they got people. Police station, they got people. RTO office, the license, RTO office, let me tell you, I'm telling you. Their tongue walketh through the earth. Verse 10. Therefore the people return hither. Therefore his people return hither. So what his people desire, think, God's people, we should also be like this. Why should not we be like this? So they also try to be like, say suppose business. He speaks lies and his business flourishes. So his people also tries that. God's people also tries that. Utter failure. The same method he tries, he is successful. So God's people also try the same method. God's people also try the same method, it becomes utter failure. The second part is very powerful, and may the Lord help you understand that. And waters of a full cup are run out to them. Waters of a full cup are run out to them. What does it mean? Waters of a full cup wrung out to them. They literally, it's a phrase when the wicked people, they live wickedly, they speak lies and do the business, their business flourishes and they get no problem. The problems what other men have, these wicked people don't have. The children are very obedient. Wife is very loving. She doesn't even question them. And she doesn't have any sickness. And his business is flourishing. So God's people, when they turned the same way, the full cup was wrung to them. The full cup was wrung out to them. What does it mean actually? The full cup was wrung out to them. God's people have to drink that bitter water or that medicine. Full cup they have to drink. The full wrath of God will come upon them. அவன் ஒரு விளங்குறக்கா தமிழில் சொல்கிறேன். அவன் பொய் சொல்லி வியாபாரம் பண்ணால் நல்லா செழிக்கிறான். இல்லை ஒரு அடல்ட்ரேட் பண்ணி வியாபாரம் பண்ணால் நல்லா செழிக்கிறான். சரி, இப்படி நம்மளும் பண்ணி பார்க்கலாமேனு காட்ஸ் பீப்புள் பண்ணி பார்க்குறாங்க. பயங்கர அடி. அந்த ஃபுல் கப் அவங்க குடிச்சாகணும். காட்ஸ் ராத்துடைய ஃபுல் கப் அவங்க குடிச்சாகும். ஒரு ட்ராப்பில் மைட் இஸ் ரன் அவுட் டு தம். It is wrung out to them. What the same thing he is doing. You are not punishing him. I am your child. The adi, terrible adi. Punishment, terrible punishment. Verse 11. And they say, how does God know? Oh, they are talking about God and all. I am giving offering to God. I go to my temple. I put all these offerings from my business. I do this puja. I have these idols, everything. God will take care. What all God you talk about? How does God know? And is there knowledge in the Most High? Right, wrong? Is there knowledge in the Most High? God is also doing the same thing. What you are talking about God and all. Verse 12. Behold, these are ungodly who prosper in the world. Who prosper in the world. It says, always at ease and tranquility. They are always at ease. No tension, no worry. They are always at ease. Verse 13. Verily, I have cleansed my heart in vain and washed my hands in innocency. No use. I'm saying I don't say lie, I don't want to fight with my wife, I want to obey my husband, etc., etc. It's a vain. Vain I have cleansed my heart and washed my hand in innocency. Verse 14. For all the day long have I been plagued and chastened every morning, all day long, throughout the day. Throughout the day, I got some problem. Problem with my husband, problem with my children, sickness, financial constraints, misunderstanding, criticisms. All day long, one problem or the other. In the morning welcomes you with a plague. The literal meaning, day starts with a problem. Day starts with a problem. I see these wicked people, they are at ease. Very cool. Very cool. But for me, day long it's a problem. And morning, day starts with a problem. Now we go to the point number 3, verses 15 and 16. Verses 15 and 16. Verse 15. If I say I will speak thus, behold, I should offend against the generation of my children. If I say this is what's happening, there is a confusion within me. But if I tell my children, I will offend them. I can't tell my children, don't believe in God, don't trust in God. If I tell my children, I will offend them. When I thought to know this, it was too painful for me. But more and more, more and more, more and more, I meditate on this. I thought to know this. It's more painful. I don't find a solution. I don't find a solution. More I think about it, it is more painful. Now I cannot speak out also. I am a Levite. I am appointed as a chief musician. By the chief of the Levites, I am appointed for a temple ministry to worship the God of Israel, to sing songs. My sons are also in the choir. But this thought train is within me. Why it's happening like this? If I speak this out, I will offend my children, the children of God. A Levite, I can't speak like this. I will offend the children of God. But I want to know why it's happening. When I want to know this, it's more painful for me. It is more painful for me. So more and more you think about it. When you think about the prosperity of the wicked, the success of the wicked, more and more you are perplexed. More and more you are confused and confounded. More and more you think about the success of the wicked. My dear brother, my dear sister, the fourth point, verses 17 and 18, the fourth point, he seeks a solution. It was a confusion for me, verse 17, until I went into the sanctuary of God. His ministry was in the sanctuary. One day he went into the sanctuary of God. Then understood I their end. I don't know how it happened. I don't know how the Lord revealed to him. He went into the sanctuary. He went into the very presence of God. When he went into the very presence of God, he says, Then understood I. I was envious of the success of the wicked. It was very painful for me to know, to think about it. I could not speak about it. It is eating me up. When I went into the sanctuary, into the very presence of God on that day, then understood I. What did he understood? Verse 18. Surely thou didst set them in slippery places. They got no problem till their end. Till their death, no problem. But truly you are setting them in slippery places. It's a very, very deep thought. Surely you are setting them in slippery places. They have no problem whatsoever. They have no problem whatsoever. It means they are standing in slippery places. Brother, sister, you got a lot of problems in your life. You are standing on a friction ground. How many of you can understand that? Come to me for a minute. He stands on a slippery ground, very polished. Any time he can fall, very smooth. More and more that place is smooth, more and more he can fall. It's very smooth. He cannot balance. The Lord makes their life very smooth. No wife problem, no children problem, no financial problem, no health problem. Very influence. Everywhere their tongue walketh, everywhere they have they got an authority. More and more their life is smooth and slippery, they got every reason to fall down. More and more your life is with friction, you will not fall. How many of you believe that? Lift up your hands and worship the Lord. We all want things to be, thank you, Tambi. This is the only one thing he understood. Till the end, they don't have, they can't balance. They can't stand. It's very smooth. They need not think about God. They need not cry to God. They need not pray to God. They need not bow down before God. There's no need for them to kneel to God. They got everything in their life. Everything in their life. No adi. No problem. Why should they pray? Why should they seek God? Why should they be good? Why should they be honest? There is no friction at all. There's no need that they should be honest. They speak lies, they are prosperous. So they speak more lies. They speak more lies. Their wife is not fighting. So they can roam with rope with any other woman. The wife will not question at all. They can live in adultery. The wife will not fight. They can bring another woman to the house. The wife will not fight. They can live with another woman. The wife will not fight. You are standing on a slippery ground. You think that you want to have a life with no sickness? You want to have a wife who cannot fight? You want to have a business with no problems? The Lord, because He loves you, He gives you a lot of friction. So you can walk carefully. And when you want to climb up the mountain, if it's a very slippery, and you've got very costly, smooth shoes, with no friction at the bottom, you will fall. If you want to run fast, you must have spurred the sole at the bottom of your shoes. Then only you can run fast. Just imagine a very, very, very smooth place and you are wearing a shoes with no grip, very polished bottom. Can you take one step? No, you have to go on doing like this only. I went into the sanctuary. There I could see, Lord, you are making them on slippery grounds. You are making them stand on slippery places, and thou costest them down into destruction. They cannot go forward. They cannot get into heaven. They fall into hell. They fall into hell. We'll move on to the fifth point. Foolish finds. He was foolish. Foolish finds. Verses 19 down. How are they brought into desolation? Because there's no need that they have to depend on God. There's no need they have to live holy. They can live in adultery. Wife is not fighting. They can do what their heart desires. There's no problem. There's no friction. More lies, more business. So they need not speak truth. More violent, more people fear them. So they can be more violent. How are they brought into desolation? As in a moment, they are utterly consumed with terrors. At least they got problem before their death. There is a chance for them to get saved, to get repented. At least to cry to the Lord, "Oh my God! Oh my God!" There was an interview, television interview with an atheist who never believed in God. When a tough question was asked to him, a very tough question was asked to him, immediately that atheist put his hand on his chin and said, "Oh my God, So the question is, at least now you think about God. At least now you think about God. He said, oh my God. At least now you think about God. If there is no suffering till that time, very peacefully he breathes last, where will he go? What will be his eternity? He had no problem because God's chastisement, God's punishment for his wickedness. He had no problem. That's God's punishment for his wickedness. He didn't even get an opportunity to repent, feel sorry for his wrongs. My dear brother, my dear sister, how are they brought into desolation as in a moment? They are utterly consumed with terrors. Verse 20. As a dream when one awaketh, so, O Lord, when thou awakest, thou shalt despise their image. They are very difficult to translate. There are two different words used in the original. When I was meditating, really first I was also confused. As a dream, when one awaketh, one who sleeps, when he awakes, as the dream passes away, so the Lord, when thou awakest, it's not that when the Lord is sleeping and the Lord has to awake from the dream. No, no. The literal meaning is when the Lord sees him. In Tamil, what we can say, avan nithrayilirundhu vilikkumbodhu neer avana paakkumbodhu. The literal meaning is thookathilirundhu mulikkumbodhu andha kanavu kalanju pora mari. He had a dream that he was a very rich man, he was living in a palace, there are 70 women around him, and he has got a very sumptuous table set for him, this is a very beautiful thing and all. When he awakes from the sleep, all that he has seen in the dream is gone. Like that, when God looks at that rich man, that prosperous man, அது ஒரு பார்வை பார்த்தார்னா போதும், எல்லாம் போயிடும், எல்லாம் போயிடும். In his hell he cannot have all these things. The suffering, eternal suffering. When you wake from the dream, as everything else would pass away, what all you have seen in the dream would have gone. Just one look of the Lord will make all these things fly away. As a dream when one awaketh, so, O Lord, when thou awakest, thou shalt despise their image. All that image they had. Verse 21. Thus my heart was grieved, and I was pricked in my veins, so foolish was I, and ignorant I was as a beast before thee. Many of us were ignorant in this. Many of us had the question, the same question what that foolish man had. Why is this friction for me? Why is this wilderness for me? Why is this difficulty for me? Probably the Lord wants you to learn something good. Probably you had to be drawn much closer to the Lord. In your battlefield, in your struggle for the Lord, more you are to be drawn closer to the Lord, more you have to see the cross. The Lord permits it. Honorable Kalanyar M. Karunanidhi, 50 years or 49 years he has completed as the president of a party. A party with the democratic principles. a party with the democratic principles. He was a lead president for 50th year. So everybody is talking about him. There are a number of things we could learn from him. Once he was asked, how was he able to withstand all these criticisms? He said, when there is a fight between Pambu and Kiri, Pambu and Kiri, Kiri ki Pambu ki chanda, Pambu will bite Kiri terribly. But in all those battles, finally, that Kiri will win. But there will be a lot of wounds on the Kiri. So Kiri will run into the forest. It'll go and wallop itself among those plants, herbal plants. Because of the medicinal value of the herbal plants, the poisonous wounds that was caused by the snake will be healed. He said, like that, I'd go read the books of Ivera Periyar. That's the medicine for me. I'll wallop myself in that. And the Kiri, Moolika Chedila Poitan Abde, Parati Adukradabola. பெரியாருடைய காரியங்களை யோசித்து புரட்டி எடுப்பேன், அந்த ஊண்டெல்லாம் ஹீல் ஆகிடும். When I was waiting in the presence of God, when in our battle against the serpent, Jesus said, a God said to that Eve, he will smash its head, bruise its head, the head of the serpent. But you can't be without pain. Serpent will bruise your heel. The excruciating pain one can encounter when our heel is bruised. That's why in the police general sometimes they'll make a criminal lie down and they'll hit on the heel. When they hit on the heel, because all the nerves end in the heel, when they hit on the heel, the pain will go up to the head, up to the brain. One whack at the heel. So when Jesus was bruising the head of Satan, Satan was bruising the heel of Jesus. He was to go through the pain. So the Bible says, look unto him. பாவிகளால் தமக்கு விரோதமாய் வந்த விரதங்களை சகித்து அவரே நோக்கிப்பார். Who endured all the contradiction that came to him from sinners. So when you are wounded in your fight, when you are bitten by serpent, go and wallop in his blood. Go and wallop in his blood. His blood will heal you. How much he was forsaken. How much he was misunderstood. How much he was rejected. How much he was falsely accused. How much they cried to his face, we don't want Jesus, we want Barabbas, we don't want Jesus, we want Barabbas. How did he bear that rejection? When you come into sanctuary, when you wallop yourself in the meditation of the cross, when we endured all contradictions of sinners, பாவிகளால் தமக்கு அந்த விபரீதங்கள் எல்லாம் சகித்தாவ, falsely accused, rejected, humiliated, counted one with the malefactors, whatever the serpent bites you got on your body, that medicine will heal you. That cross will heal you. The cross will heal you. My dear brother, my dear sister, so foolish was I and ignorant. I was as a beast before thee, Lord. I was a beast before thee. Verse 6. His confidence, whatever the situations may be, his confidence, verse 23 to 26, nevertheless, whatsoever it may be, I am continually with the first decision. Lord, whether I understand or not, I will continually be with thee. Take a solemn resolution now. They are falsely accusing you. You are not successful. You are rejected. The husband rejects the wife and chooses somebody else. The wife is unable to bear it. See on the cross one who was rejected. A criminal was favored for him. Think about him. You can bear your rejection. It will break our hearts. We will be hurt, wounded. Wallop yourself in the meditation of the cross. Wallop yourself in the meditation of the cross. Nevertheless, whatsoever it may be, Lord, I am continually with thee. Number 2, thou hast holden me by my right hand. I will not slip away. This chastisement, this rejection, this pain, this disappointment, this loss, this everything, it's because you are holding my hand, not because you have forsaken me. You don't want me to fall down. That's why this friction. You are holding me by my right hand. Number 3, thou shalt guide me with thy counsel. Number 3, when I had to turn to the left or to the right, your anointing, your presence, your word, your testimonies, your statutes, your law, Lord, you will guide me with thy counsel. Number 4. And afterward, or at the end, when you make me walk through your counsel, at the end, whatever others can do for you, however ignominy you have to bear in this world, whatever the spit on your face, whatever the rejection could be by your husband, by your wife, by your children, by your parents, by your society, by your church, by the congregation, by anybody, I tell you, God will receive you to his glory. Your son might have rejected you. Your daughter might have rejected you. My sister, my brother, in the name of Jesus, I tell you, the society could have rejected you. God will receive you to glory. Don't be worried about the pains and the agonies you have today. God will receive you to glory. Number 5, verse 25. When I have in heaven but thee, and there is none upon earth that I desire beside thee. Tam dam tunayana nayandurai sonnava nattattil vittaraya enduraye elaki aadhara needanaya. Elaki aadhara needanaya. In this world, you are my sustenance. When I go to heaven, you will be there to receive me. What more I need? What more I need? I tell you, brother, sister, not to hurt you, but to make you understand. Sometime back, I was sitting and talking with one pastor. I was sharing this with him. In the wilderness, when God was angry with the people, when God said, Moses, you stand aside, I'll consume all these people. I'll destroy all these people. They are stiff-necked people. None of them will go to my promised land. I'll destroy them in this wilderness. When God was angry, Moses stood between God and the people of Israel and cried, Lord, don't destroy them. If you want to destroy them, write off my name. You have brought them all this way to be destroyed in the wilderness, Lord. Brought them out of Egypt through the Red Sea. All these days in the wilderness, not to destroy them. He was standing between God and the people. Years passed by. One day God said, Moses will not go to Canaan. Moses will not go to Canaan. There was not one Israelite to plead for Moses. Joshua didn't say, Lord, if Moses doesn't go, don't take me to Canaan. There's not one Joshua to plead for Moses. There was not one Caleb to plead for Moses. There was not one Israelite in those 3 lakhs to plead for Moses. Everybody was happy. If I go to Canaan, it's okay whether Moses comes or Moses doesn't come. A few years back, the same Moses was to cry. If you don't take them to Canaan, write off my name, Lord. But when God says, I will not take Moses to Canaan, okay, Lord, okay. For all the years of his ministry, suffering with the people, that is the love he got in return. There's not one person to plead his cause on the Mount of Transfiguration. Moses was with Jesus talking. God didn't forsake Moses. You may not have the love of the people whom you loved. You may not have the love of the people. You may not have the love of your children for whom you lived. But Jesus will not forsake you. He didn't go to Canaan. Yes, you're doing a lot of ministry. Maybe as a missionary you suffer for the people. Resign your job. God called you. I don't know why I say this. You may not have a return. I love these people. I pleaded for them. But what's that I got in return? Okay, Lord, Moses doesn't go. It's okay, Lord. Take us to Canaan, O Lord. We must go to Canaan, O Lord. Whether Moses comes or Moses doesn't come, we don't care. That's the love Moses had in return. There's not one Joshua, there's not one Caleb, there's not one person to pray. They have seen Moses praying for them. But God will not forsake you, brother. You may not get Canaan. You may not get Canaan of this earth. You may not get the fruits of Canaan. The milk and honey of Canaan. But you will be with Jesus on the Mount of Transfiguration. You'll be sitting and talking with him. You'll be one with him. God will not leave you. God will not forsake you. Verse 26, my flesh and my heart faileth. My flesh and my heart faileth. My body cannot help me. My strength may not help me. My money may not help me. Even my thinking, my emotions, my likes, my dislikes, my heart may fail me. God is the strength of my heart. He doesn't say God is the strength of my body. My body will fail. My body may fail. I may not have the same physical health what I had some years back. I may not have the same physical health today. I may not run as I was running. My flesh will fail. But Lord, you are the strength of my heart. Let come what may. God will not allow my heart to fail. If I allow my heart, the pain, the agony, the words, the insults, the things, eats me up. Why this ministry, Lord? Everywhere treachery, Lord. My heart fails me. My flesh also fails me. But God is the strength of my heart. May not be the strength of my flesh, but God will be the strength of my heart. The seventh point, he comes into the final verdict. He had a confusion, he saw the prosperity of the wicked, he saw how the children of God, even for a small mistake, how much they have to suffer. Everything he has seen. He has got a conviction, Lord, as far as I am concerned, nevertheless I will cling on to you, O Lord. You will hold me by your right hand. You will receive me to your glory. Whether others receive me or not into their house, you will receive me to the glory, O Lord. Even if I rejected everybody, children, our parents, our neighbors, friends, you will receive me to glory, O Lord. Even my body and my flesh and my heart fail me, my thought process, my thinking, my emotions, my likes and dislikes, they fail me. You are the strength of my heart. You are the strength of my heart. Now he comes to a conclusion, verse 27 and 28. For look, see, they that are far from thee shall perish, if it's not today, tomorrow. They shall perish. Thou hast destroyed all them that go a warring from thee. You'll destroy them. They don't have any problem till their end. That is their destruction. There was a great atheist. He had a board on his house. God is nowhere. A very big board. God is nowhere. He was about to die. Crying and shouting, reading that word. God is now here. God is now here. Nowhere. N-O-W-H-E-R-E. He was crying and shouting. Now here. N-O-W-H-E-R-E. It was too late for him. It was too late for him. He was destroyed in his atheism. He cried, God is now here. He could not die in peace. My dear brother, my dear sister, he writes the final verdict. For look, they that are far from thee shall perish. Thou hast destroyed all them that go a warring from thee. Verse 28. But it is good for me to draw nearer to God. When I was suggesting this song, Draw Me Nearer to Thee, not because of this message, but it is good for me to draw near to God. I have put my trust in the Lord. I have put my trust in the Lord, that may I declare all His works. That I may declare all His works. Wilderness will come. Mara will be bitter. You may have to walk 3 days, 3 nights without a water. water you could see would be bitter. You may not have wine. You may not have olives. You may not have wheat. You may not have barley. There will be no place for you where you could bury the dead ones. Amalekites will be against you. I'm not promising a smooth life. I'm promising you that you have to walk without water for 3 days and three nights. I'm promising you you'll go through a wilderness where there is no wine, where there is no wheat, where there is no barley, where there is no olives. You'll face foot of Jericho. Giants will be there, my son. Before their eyes, he will be like a grasshopper. He'll be too small to fight your battles. There will be fortified cities, trained military. Seven races, three kings, well-established cities opposing you. Do you want to follow me? Do you want to cling on to me? Are you willing to walk 3 days, three nights without water? Are you willing to taste the water of Mara? Are you willing to face the Amalekites? Are you willing to walk around Jericho for 7 days? On the seventh day, seven times around that you have to walk. Are you willing? If you are willing to go through all these frictions, I tell you, I will not leave you. I will not forsake you. Now I know, truly, God is good. God is good unto his people. The Red Sea is good. Mara is good. Walking without water for 3 nights, 3 days is good. Amalekites coming against us is good. When we traverse the wilderness where there is no wine, there is no olive, where there is no barley, there is no wheat, it's good. Then I could see how Mara could be turned into sweet waters. Then I could see how God could provide for manna which my forefathers didn't know. Then I could see how Fort of Jericho could fall. Then I know how I could inherit a city that flows with milk and honey. Shall we stand to our feet? Tell the Lord, truly you are good. Truly you are good, O Lord. I will continually cling on to you. Hold me by my right hand. Receive me to your glory. In heaven there is no one. On the earth also, not my husband, not my wife, not my children, not my friends. Moses. You may see no Joshua, you may see no Caleb to intercede for you. God will not leave you. He will receive you to his glory. All this Mara, all this wilderness, all this Fort of Jericho is only, it's a prophecy to somebody. It is only for you to see the glory of God. குடிக்க ஒரு சொட்டு தண்ணீர் இல்லாமல் மூன்று இரவு மூன்று பகலே நடக்கிறது. திராட்சை பழமும் இல்லை, கோதுமையும் இல்லை, வார்கோதுமையும் இல்லை, ஒலிவ மரமும் இல்லை, அத்திப்பழமும் இல்லை. எதுக்கு தெரியுமா? இவன் வாழ்க்கையில் மன்னாவை பார்ப்பதற்காக சோர்ந்து போகாது, சோர்ந்து போகாது. முன்னால் உனக்கு தண்ணி இல்லைன்னு தெரியுமா? For you to see how waters can come out of a rock. For you to see how waters can come out of a rock. Hallelujah. Why you have to walk around this fort of Jericho? There's no way for you. Why is the Lord allowing me to walk around this Jericho? For you to see how Jericho could tumble down. How Jericho could tumble down. For you to see that, not to leave you. Not to forsake you. Truly, God is good. Oh, shall we pray?